Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you to the service. Our service is going to start off with a short video. But before the video, I'd like to call your attention to the heart-shaped wreath on my left and your right. In light of the fact that it's very close to Miss Jo's birthday, which would have been June 27th, it would have been her 92nd birthday, and very close to her and HB's wedding anniversary, which would have been July the 3rd. HB was always giving money to Janie and said, here, go buy your mama something. He sounded like my kind of shop. Here, honey, go buy mama something and pick it out real nice and tell her I picked it out, okay? But anyway, the heart-shaped bouquet was for her. And the message reads, to Joe, welcome home, love, B. And that's what she called it. Gathered here today to remember the life of Sarah Jo Bookhardt Thomas, who on Monday, May the 27th, went to be with the Lord. It was only 2 years ago that Sister Jo was recognized as the oldest living member of Providence Baptist Church. And it was only 4 years ago that we were standing in the same place and the family sitting in the same place, saying goodbye to H.B., Joe's husband. You know, God in His great mercy has not told us when we're going to leave this earth, only that we will someday. Our love and our heartfelt prayers go out to you, this family, today, your mourning. And although we weep, our tears should not be for her. They should be for ourselves because we are left behind in a sin-stricken world. I commend you for standing by your mama and thanking her to be close to you. And I know that you were there for her. I'd like to also commend Harry and Pat for taking care of the home place and being a good friend to you at particular times. And Janie, my heart goes out to you today also because in such a short time, you not only had to say goodbye to your daddy, you also said goodbye to your husband. And now you're saying goodbye to your mama. So our prayers are with you in a great way. God's going to be honored and glorified today. We're going to rejoice in this worship service. It's just going to fill our hearts with the presence of Christ. We're going to learn what it's all about. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, many times on this side of the grave, we will come to this opportunity, Lord, to show our respects, show our love, and show our grief. The only thing we can pray, Father, that you will make yourself real to each and every one of us. Lord, our hearts must be ready to go at any time. We're not all promised a long life like Job. Our life could end very quickly and very soon. In the next few moments and the next few minutes together, Lord, help us to have a heart check, a gut check, and find out where we stand with you. Knowing that your Son, Jesus, is the door to heaven, we must have Him as our Lord and Savior to be reunited again on the other side with Joe and H.B. So have your will and way. In Jesus' name we pray. And all the Lord's people said,
Amen. Amen.
Now this time we're going to worship the Lord in song. God's going to come and lead us.
If you will,
please stand with me as we sing hymn number 333. 333, first and the last verse.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I am How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Our New Testament lesson and our message today will come out of John's Gospel, chapter 11. I'm going to play leapfrog and read part of the story because time does not permit me to read the entire chapter. But you probably are familiar with the chapters, the story of Lazarus, his death and his resurrection from the dead at the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. Beginning in chapter 11, verse 1. Now a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary, her sister, and her sister Martha. And it was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his hair with her feet, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, him whom thou lovest is sick. And Jesus heard that he said that the sickness is not unto death, but unto the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. And after that, said he to his disciples, let us go unto Jerusalem, or Judea, again. Then now in verse 14, Then said Jesus unto them, plainly, Lazarus is dead. And I'm glad that for your sake that I was not there to the intent that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Then when Jesus came and he found that he had lain in the grave for 4 days already, and now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem about 15 furlongs, many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she had heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee. Jesus again said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die, believe thou this. She said unto him, Yea, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. And when she had so said, she went her way and called Mary her sister secretly, saying, The Master is come and calls for you. As soon as she heard that, she rose quickly and came unto him. Now Jesus was not yet come to the town, but was in the place where Martha met him. Then when Mary was come unto Jesus, and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Jesus said, therefore, as he saw her weeping, that the Jews also weeping, which came with her, groaned in spirit as he was troubled. And he said, where have you laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, behold, how he loved him. And some of them said, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died? And then we go down to verse 40. Jesus said unto her, said I not unto thee, if you would believe, you should see the glory of God? And they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said that they may believe that you have sent me. When he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. He that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes. And his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus said unto them, loose him and let him go. And many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did believed on him. I'd like to take just a few moments to share with you about the Joe that I knew. We can never get away from that contagious smile and laugh that Sister Joe had. And I'm thankful that Miss Joe was a friend to me. She was a pastor's friend. I never heard her make a disparaging remark to me or about me. Her next to me was truly, truly a pastor's wife's friend. As I visited with Janie and Henry at the old house on Friday, it brought back some memories of better times. And I would drop by to see HB and Joe, and Daisy would be on the back porch, who still, by the way, is still kicking, still alive at the age of 18. You almost be feeding him good, her good, right? Mr. Red sitting in the chair. He's come along and been departed. H.P. would have his hand out. Hey, preacher. And Miss Joe said with that contagious smile, hey, pastor, it's so good to see you. And she'd laugh every time. Even when she was in the hospital, couldn't get away from that smile. I understand that when she went to Parkview to live out the rest of the days of her life, according to the workers, it was a dreary place until Joe showed up. And with her smile and her contagious laugh, she changed it. I remember the first time that when HB passed, that I went into the home, since then, Miss Joe passed. You walked in the home, and it's almost like walking back in time. Everything was right in place. Everything was neat. There was no dust, no nothing, just like they had just stepped out to go to the store. Everyone should be as frugal about their home like that. And I also remember the story that she told me when HB passed about when she was visiting from Florida, and HB saw her in that bright yellow sundress, and he said, who is that? I got to meet her. And then the rest of it is history. Now, because of their relationship with Christ, both are together today in God's celestial kingdom. Now, I'd like to take a moment and share with you a letter from Lee. Lee's heart is hurt today because he and Caleb could not be here. And most of you understand why. But Lee loved his grandma. I'm sure all of you did. But he wrote these words and asked that I would share them with you, and so I will do so at this time. His memories of his grandma. What might seem like little things to some weren't so little, my granny. She enjoyed reading the comments in the newspaper, and she referred to them as the funnies. Cards for Mother's Day and birthdays meant more to her than the bought gifts that accompanied them. She never needed the latest or the greatest, but she never believed in buying cheap shoes. She must be kin to my wife. She always put her family before herself, and we never wanted for anything except more of a cooking. I've never known a better cook. She told me that as long as you had salt, sugar and butter, you could fix just about anything. I can still taste and smell the aroma of her fried chicken, and gravy. Gravy that I like to refer to as my favorite beverage. Her corn, her okra, her tomatoes made Paula Deen seem like an amateur. And what I wouldn't give for one more slice of her key lime pie. She loved feeding people. And we know this would be true. Any stray dog or cat came around, or any stray person came around, she'd make sure that they left something in the stomach. Not just her family. Growing up, I'd always brought friends over to her house. And I can still hear her saying, "Have some more." I don't think she had the ability to fix a small meal at any time. Now, as far as her favorite food to eat, I can't think of anything she enjoyed more than dark chocolate, Hershey's dark chocolate. She referred to them as purple bells since they came in a purple wrapper. She had lots of sayings, and every time she'd first see me, it was, "Hey, Jaybird." She wasn't exactly a slowpoke when she drove. And every time when she pulled up to a stop sign or a green light, she'd say, "Hold on to what you got." My granny was friendly, and you never doubted how important you were to her. Granny's love was without condition and without fail. We could always count on her to listen, to comfort, and to help. If you needed something done, all you had to do was call Granny. She enjoyed music. Cave Galloway, Dixieland, jazz, and Willie Nelson, just to name a few. She even got to meet Mark Chestnut while on vacation in Nashville at the Grand Ole Opry. She used to watch the Orlando Magic and was a fan of Shaquille O'Neal. I'll be forever grateful that her and my pop raised me right by making sure I was a Clemson fan. Since before I can remember. And even though we lived through the Ken Hatfield years, I'm sure everyone had memories much like mine. They're all beautiful memories, something we'll always have to cherish. It isn't often in our lives that we come across someone so special that a person stays with you forever. Granny was that kind of person, with her passion. I try not to look at this, God took her from us, but rather he gave us her for as long as he did. I know she's with my pop in heaven after a life so lovingly lived. Very well written. And I hope you get to watch this by video, and our love and prayers are with you and Caleb also. Now I'd like to take a minute to share some scripture with you. Before I do,
we have one more hymn to sing. Yes.
We're going to sing "What a Friend We Have in Jesus," and then I'm going to share a message with you in our heart of the day. So, buddy.
I'm going to stand with me, please. And hymn number we're going to sing is hymn number 182. "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." We'll sing the first and the third verse.
"What a Friend We Have."
John chapter 11, as I often call it, the preview of the resurrection, I just want to share with you three points about what we read in John's gospel, and this part of the service will be concluded. First of all, I want you to know that the Bible says that Lazarus was sick. Now, it doesn't matter how long we live, we do know this: sickness is going to come. Now, if you live to get past 50, as I tell many people, doctors will become your best friends. And you begin setting your life by what doctor you're going to see this week. And whether you like it or not, and I admire people who hold out the hand and said, "I don't take no pills," they're probably lying, but nevertheless, you will become a pill popper. When I turned 65, I was introduced to this wonderful little contraption called Weekly Reminders. You know what I'm talking about. It's just a simple plastic box you buy at Walgreens. It's got Monday through Sunday on it. And you open it up and say, "Well, there's my pills for today." Now, when you get a little age on you, you start playing this game, because you come to Monday, you pop it open, and it's empty. And you start playing the game, what happened to Monday's pills? Now, I really admire these people who's got 30 days, but man, they got everything lined up. But I promise you, your trips to the doctors, your trips to the drugstores, you get that bodacious basket full of pills, and then you have to organize, you have to know when to take. Well, that's part of life. Now, wouldn't it be wonderful as we got older if we could choose our sickness? We're not told what kind of sickness Lazarus had. But wouldn't it be wonderful? Well, I tell you, I'm old and I know that I've got to have a sickness. Maybe I'll have heart disease. Or maybe will we ever say, "Well, let me deal with cancer." Well, those are foolish words, aren't they? The Bible says that age does this thing, that does three things to you. It gives you a crooked back, gray hair, and dimness of eyes. And I can tell you all of that is true. But I can also tell you there's one sickness that no human being would ever wish on themselves. And that is the sickness of the mind. Now, as the family and the friends know, that Miss Jo started suffering with dementia. I don't know how bad it got. I hadn't seen her in 4 years. But the sickness of losing your mind and your mind just going from you is something that is more debilitating than anything we could ever face on this earth. Yet statistics tells us that 1 out of every 10 people in this room will suffer dementia, and 2/3 of all the ladies will suffer from Alzheimer's. But no matter what kind of sickness we ever have, just remember this. When we get so old and feeble that we don't remember who Jesus is, He always remembers who we are. Our name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and we can't ever get so sick that God does not care for us in the hour of our affliction. Remember that. Well, the second thing the Bible says is that Lazarus was dead. It was a funeral so sad. So sad. Why? Because Jesus was just a mountain away. He could have been there. Life was on its way. A lot of questions suffered. Why didn't Jesus come? Well, He spoke these words to Martha. He said, "I am the resurrection and I am the life." They were fussing at Him about being late, but when Jesus is late, He's still always on time. And He said, "Martha, don't you understand? The resurrection is here right in front of you." Now, according to the Bible, there are two ways to heaven. One is the way that we're all going to have to go, most of us, and that's through death. The second is through the second coming of Jesus when Christ parts the eastern sky and returns. But only one generation will experience that. The rest of us will go through the process of what we're doing right now. Well, the Bible tells us that we must set our houses in order for that day is coming. Now, as I speak with you, I trust and pray that your house is in order, that you've made preparation, spiritually speaking, with your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He's the only salvation way. You understand that. He's the only door to heaven. There is no other way. There is no religion. There is no religious person. There is only the Son of God that can save your soul and forgive you of your sin. So make that preparation, because you will be like Lazarus one day. You will be dead, and I will also. But the third thing the Bible says is that Lazarus was alive. Jesus shows up. Glory to God. Isn't it wonderful when he shows up? And he spoke. Show me where you lay. So he's been dead a while. I said, don't worry about that. Just show me where you lay. And he says, take the stone away from the door. Lazarus has got to get out of there. Then he speaks the words recorded in the Word of God. Lazarus, come forth. As I said, this is a preview of the resurrection. Because the Bible says that one day, he will not single out Lazarus, but he will speak from the clouds and say, come forth. And all those who are in the grave shall rise, some to eternal life and some to eternal destruction. Praise God for this message and this story that gives hope to us as mankind. But the last thing he said to him, I think, was the best. He was wrapped in grave clothes. He had a napkin over his face. And Jesus said, loose him and let him go. That means set him free. Loose those bands. Let him walk around. Let him be free again. Let him live life because he is alive. Well, one day, God's going to call us to his celestial kingdom. In that time, we will be loosed. We will be free from all sickness. No more doctor visits. No more wondering where the pills went. No more doctor bills. Can you say amen to that? But we'll also be free from sin. What a glorious world it will be, friends, when we step into God's kingdom where there will be no hate, no sin, no suffering, no sorrow, no grief, no biasness, no prejudice. It will all be gone away. And then lastly, we will be free from separation. As the hymn writer said, there will be no sad goodbyes ever spoken in God's wonderful kingdom. Here's what the song says. I'm kind of homesick, like I've never been so far. Homesick for a place called heaven, where no sad goodbyes will ever be spoken. In a place the Bible calls Beulah Land. Oh, Beulah Land, I'm longing for you. And one day, on the aisle stand, I'm looking forward to it. How about you? Bow your heads with me, please. While our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, I ask you to examine your relationship with the God of all heaven. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The Bible says if we confess our sins, that he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us. If you've never asked Christ into your heart and life, I ask you to do that right now. I'm not going to make a public spectacle of you, but right now, ask Christ into your life. Say, Lord, I want to be saved. I want to go to that celestial kingdom where there won't be any goodbyes. If you're a Christian today, but you're not living for the Lord as you should, and you know it, confess your sins. Say, Lord, it's been ages since I've been in church. It's been longer than that since I've opened my Bible. And even longer since I prayed that they forgive me of my sinfulness. I want to start living for you again. And the Lord of love will take you back into his fellowship and you'll start life all over again. God, thank you for this time. Thank you for this dear family. Bless them in their loss, Lord. Thank you for Joe. Thank you for her life and thank you for her friendship. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. All the family rise, remainder of the service.